نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، فهذا أيها الإخوة لقاء جديد يتجدد بالخير والبركة إن شاء الله، والتواصي بالحق والتواصي بالصبر في بيئة كما قلنا في المجلس الماضي الغربة فيها مضاعفة. غرفة الوطن، غربة الوطن، وغربة الدين، وغربة السنة. وبالتالي فإن الواجب يكبر أكثر وأكثر كلما ازدادت المسؤولية. فلو أن الإنسان كان منفردا لكانت مسؤوليته عن نفسه، لكن إذا كانت له زوجة فإن مسؤوليته تزداد. فكيف إذا كان له زوجة وأبناء، وقد يكون له آباء؟ فمن باب أولى وأولى أن تزداد هذه المسؤولية.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أبو الشيخ إخوان أبو الحارث الحلبي حفظه الله تعالى began by saying after reciting Khutbat al-Hajj and praising Allah Azza wa Jal and sending the salutations and peace and blessings on Rasulullah salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, he said, my brothers, this is a new meeting, another opportunity where we renew our meeting with each other, and we hope for it good and blessing inshaAllah ta'ala, with what is khair and barakah, where we come together to mutually advise each other with the truth and to advise each other the importance of being patient, especially as it relates to the environment in which we're living in right now, as we mentioned before in one of our last talks, where the ghurba or the strangeness that we're dealing with and what we're living in, it becomes compounded and it's mudaf. We have the strangeness that comes as a result of where we live, the actual place in the Watan, where we are afraid, we are away from where we live. Also, because of our environment here, there is a strangeness of the deen. Our religion is different from the religion that these people are upon. And finally, we have the strangeness of trying to be upon the sunnah and holding on to the sunnah. As a result of that, a direct result of that, the responsibility that we all have, it becomes more increased and more profound. If one of us was here individually and we were responsible for our individual selves, then it is a serious issue and a serious level of responsibility. That responsibility becomes even greater and even more serious when we have people who are under our authority, like your wife, or if you are a person who has a parent, or if you're an individual who has children, then obviously the responsibility, it becomes even more greater.
وإذ الأمر كذلك فإن كلامنا سيكون موجها إلى صورة واقعية وإلى حالة موجودة. لا نتكلم عن أمر نحن نقول بمشروعيته، فإنه لا يخفى عليكم جميعا تحذيرنا المتكرر منذ سنوات وسنوات، وكذلك أيضا طلبنا وطلب علمائنا من قبل بأن الهجرة الشرعية تكون إلى بلاد المسلمين ليس من بلاد المسلمين، وبالتالي فإن الأصل أن الإقامة في مثل هذه البلاد والمكث فيها إنما هو طارئ لظرف طارئ، حيث إذا زال السبب زال هذا الواقع وانقضى هذا الحكم. فلا يظنن ظان أننا بكلامنا عن الأسرة النموذجية في الغرب إنما نقر حكما مشروعا، وإنما نحن نعالج واقعا طارئا لا خيار فيه لصاحبه إلا بالصبر والحرص على تغيير هذا الواقع إلى ما هو أعلى منه وأجل.
The Sheikh says, so therefore, based upon that, the talk or the kalam that we're going to present to you today, it is a speech and an advice and a lecture that comes as a result of a reality that we're living, a reality that is present, that we're dealing with. And as we give these talks about what we're going to explain to you right now, it should be understood that we are warning as we have warned in the past. And we continue to warn right now. We warned about this in the years gone by, and we continue to warn about this. And our ulama, our scholars, warn about this issue, and that is that making the hijrah is a concept that is from this religion, and it is something that has been legislated in this deen, that the hijrah is from this place to the place where the Muslims live, and not the other way. The correct legislative hijrah is to where the Muslims live. So the origin of this ruling and this issue is that we do not live as Muslims with the non-Muslims. But as a result of an emergency situation may occur, and as a result of that, people are forced to be in a place like this. And if whatever forced you and compelled you to be here, if that reason leaves and it's no longer present, then the hukum or the permissibility of living here also, it changes. Meaning you shouldn't live here after that. So I don't want anyone to think by any stretch of the imagination, don't let anyone think that when we talk about the ideal Muslim family, do not think that we don't recognize the impermissibility of staying in this place. We're not encouraging people to stay here. No, we encourage the people to hold on to the legislative ruling of the impermissibility of staying here. But in speaking and addressing this issue, we are trying to give the ilaj and the solution to the reality of what we're living and what we're experiencing right here.
فإن مقومات الأسرة المسلمة النموذجية في الغرب إنما تأخذ هذا النموذج من دينها ومما يتصل بشريعتها، فهي لا شرقية ولا غربية، وإنما إسلامية ربانية محمدية، أساس وجودها الدين، وقوام ثباتها اتباع سنة سيد المرسلين صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وهذا هو الأصل الأول، وهو دينها أن تكون هذه الأسرة المسلمة النموذجية محافظة على دينها، فدينها سبب وجودها. وإذا لم تكن هذه الأسرة المسلمة محافظة على دينها فهي حينئذ في مهب الريح، لا وجود لها ولا قيام لها ولا حقيقة لها، تراها متفككة، تراها تنافس أهل الفجور فجورهم وأهل الكفر كفرهم، وليس لها حينئذ إذا زاد هذا البلاء وتضاعف هذا اللأواء لا يكون منها من دينها إلا الإثم والعياذ بالله تبارك وتعالى. ولئن كانت الحالات التي يحصل فيها ردة قليلة، أعني في الظاهر، لكن بعض الناس قد لا يعرف أنه مسلم لأنه يعيش بين ظهراني غير المسلمين ويأخذ عاداتهم وطبائعهم وسلوكياتهم وينسى دينه الذي هو سبب وجوده. فالأسرة المسلمة إذا أرادت أن تكون نموذجا حيا حقيقيا فعليها أول ما يجب عليها أن تحافظ على دينها، لأن الحفاظ على الدين وأصله العبادة، وأصل العبادة الأركان الخمسة، هي سبب الخلق. وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون، ما أريد منهم من رزق وما أريد أن يطعمون، إن الله هو الرزاق ذو القوة المتين. قل إن صلاتي ونسكي ومحياي ومماتي لله رب العالمين لا شريك له، وبذلك أمرت وأنا أول المسلمين. لم يخلقنا الله للغدو والرواح والأكل والشرب والنوم والاستيقاظ والزوجة والولد والمال والدار، إنما خلق هذا كله لأجل أن نحقق العبادة والدين الذي هو سبب وجودنا نحن المسلمين، سواء كان ذلك في الغرب أم في الشرق، سواء كان ذلك في الفرد أو في الأسرة أو في المجتمع كله.
After that, Ikhwan, the Sheikh, he went on to say, as it relates to the ideal Muslim family, there are many muqawwamat, many issues that will help it to stand up, to exist on the proper way that is expected. And this ideal Muslim family, one of the ways that it becomes ideal, it should be understood, is not an issue that is connected to it being from the East or it being from the West. It has nothing to do with that. But it is, and it has everything to do with it being Islamic. Everything to do with being the Rabbani from Allah Azza wa Jal. Being Muhammadiyya, connected to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. And this is the foundation of the Muslim family. And that is the religion itself, the deen. And following Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. This is the foremost issue. It is the asl of the whole existence of the Muslim family. That Muslim family is taking care to hold on and to protect its religion. The Sheikh, he went on to say that the deen, the religion of Islam, it is the reason why the Muslim family exists in the first place. And if it does not hold on to the deen, then it is just out there in the wind, blowing around and being blown. It has no reality to it. It has no real presence to it. It is unable to stand up properly as it has been intended to do. If the Muslim family does not hold on to the religion of Al-Islam, it will find every way to cater to the evil of the evildoers and the kufr of the non-believers. The Sheikh said, it will just be a family, that's all, a family by name, without the deen, without the religion. So we'll find the individual who grows up in a family that consists of Muslims, when they don't hold on to the deen, they'll grow up and they'll just exist in, but they don't know anything about the reality. They don't even know, the person may not even know that he is a Muslim. He grows up and he lives amongst the kuffar and he lived like them because he had no concept, he had no idea of what his religion was all about. So he resembled the non-Muslims in their behavior, in their akhlaq. And he forgets totally and absolutely his religion. So if a person really wants to have a family that is an Islamic family, then the first thing he has to do, if he wants that family to live, to be a living family, he has to hold on, and they have to hold on to their deen and have the muhafaza on the deen. So the origin of this issue is that the family is a family that is worshiping Allah Azza wa Jal according to the five arkan of al-Islam, as Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned in the Quran, and we have not created the jinn and the mankind except to worship me, Allah said. I do not want from them to give me rizq or to feed me. Instead, Allah is al-Razzaq, and He is the most powerful, and He is al-Mateen. And Allah also said in the Quran, say, verily my salat and my sacrifice, my life and my death are for Allah, the Lord of all the world. This is what I've been ordered to do, and I am the first of those who are from the Muslims. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He has not created us to eat, to drink, to get married. He has not created us to get married, to have children for our wives. He has not created us for the homes that we have or for the money that we collect. No, instead, what He created us for was His exclusive worship. And that is the first point that has to be understood, that the deen is what will make the Muslim family a Muslim family. Has nothing to do with being in the West, has nothing to do with being in the East, has nothing to do with whether you are an individual, has nothing to do with whether you are a group of people, has nothing to do with the society in terms of number. It has everything to do with holding on to the deen.
وأما الأصل الثاني الذي تكون به الأسرة المسلمة نموذجية وبخاصة في الغرب وحدتها أن تكون أسرة متوحدة لا متفككة متشرذمة متقطعة وإنما تكون هذه الأسرة متوحدة قائما توحدها على قول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته فالرجل راع في بيته له مسؤوليات والمرأة أيضا راعية في بيتها لها مسؤوليات أخرى الولد الكبير له مسؤوليات على إخوانه الصغار الوالدان لهم أيضا مسؤولية أعني والدي الزوجين فكثير من الناس من المسلمين ولله الحمد من يعطفون ويبرون أباءهما أو أباهم ولا يفعلون كما نسمع وكما نرى أن الآباء إذا وصلوا إلى سن الستين أو أقل من ذلك وأكثر فإن لهم الملاجئ وإن لهم الأماكن التي فيها رعاية هؤلاء الكبار هذا لا يعرفه المسلم لأن هذا ليس من البر بل هذا والله من العقوق والمسلم الذي يعرف الحقوق لا يعرف العقوق الله تبارك وتعالى يقول وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا فقرن ربنا جل وعلا بر الوالدين والإحسان إليهما مع العبادة لما لهما من حق والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول الوالد أوسط أبواب الجنة ويقول عليه الصلاة والسلام رضا الله من رضا الوالد وسخط الله من سخط الوالد والله عز وجل استرعى أنظار المسلمين إلى وحدة الأسرة وإلى ائتلافها في كتابه في مواضع عدة منها قوله تبارك وتعالى: وأمر أهلك بالصلاة واصطبر عليها. ومنها قوله تبارك وتعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا وقودها الناس والحجارة. وفي قوله واصطبر فائدة، فمن لغة العرب ودقائقها أن كل زيادة في المبنى زيادة في المعنى، فالصبر غير الاصطبار. الصبر هو تحمل الأمور واحتمالها، والاصطبار هو الثبات على ذلك والمجاهدة له، بحيث يكون الاصطبار أعلى من مجرد الصبر. ووجود هذه الأسرة المسلمة في وحدتها مبني على أمرين سبق أولهما، وهو البر ومعرفة الحقوق، وأما الثاني فهو إدراك الخلاف واستدراكه وعدم توسعه، والحل الشرعي له: إن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول. كثير من حالات الخلاف الزوجي نرى أن المرأة بسبب أقل خلاف والعياذ بالله تطلب الخلع من زوجها أو تطلب الطلاق، وهي لا تظن ولا تعلم بل تجهل أن ذلك من الكبائر. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أي امرأة طلبت الطلاق من زوجها من غير ما بأس لم ترح رائحة الجنة. وهذا من ألفاظ النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام التي تدل على أن هذا من الكبائر، بينما إذا استعملنا الطرق الشرعية في حل الخلاف كان ذلك من أعظم أسباب وحدة الأسرة، لتكون نموذجا يقتدى بها كما هي في دينها، هي في اجتماعها ولم شملها ووحدة كلمتها.
Brothers, please, inshallah, can you make another effort to just move forward a little bit more so the brothers outside can get in at the back. Look in front of you. If there's a bit of space, move forward. Jazakumullah khair, especially over there against the wall, if you can move your legs in and so the brothers can move around. Jazakumullah khair.
The Sheikh Ikhwani said, as for the second point, the second pillar, the second issue that I want to advise in and I want to talk about, that the Muslim family will stand upon as it relates to the ideal Muslim family, especially here in the West, is the unity of the family, the togetherness of the family, that the family is together and not the family is dispersed and separated and in different places. And this second issue, it comes as a result that we understand from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, who said, all of you are shepherds and all of you will be held responsible for your flock. The Sheikh went on to say, so in the Muslim family, the man, the husband, he is responsible for his home, and he has many responsibilities connected to that home. And the Muslim woman, the wife, she is also a person who has many responsibilities that are different from the responsibilities of the husband. In addition to that, the children, they have responsibilities, like the eldest son, for an example, the eldest child. They are responsible, and he is responsible for his younger brothers and sisters. And the parents of the husband and the wife, the grandparents of the children, if they're in the home, the grandparents, the parents of the husband and the wife, they are also people who inside of that home, inside of their family, they have responsibility. We know that there are many Muslims who do good and they have birr and they're diligent in taking care of the rights of their fathers and their mothers. But also at the same time, we have heard and we have seen how there are some people, especially here, who are of a foreign understanding. That is, if the mother and the father, or the mother or the father, one of them reaches the age of 60, a little more, a little less. When they reach that age, the Muslim in this place sometimes tend to put that parent in a convalescent home, a home for old people, a home for old folks who are responsible now for taking care of people who are elderly. The Sheikh said, this is something that the Muslim in reality doesn't know. He doesn't know this. It's not from the behavior of the Muslim. And this is not from al-birr. This is not from taking care of the parent. Instead, this is from the uquq, from being disobedient to one's parent. The Muslim who does not know the huquq or the rights of the parent, he will fall into al-aquq, being disobedient to the parent. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned in the Quran, verily, your Lord has made it an obligation. Your Lord has legislated that you should do nothing but worship Him and that you should have birr to your parents. Allah has made the qadha. He has legislated that you worship Him alone and that you are good and you have ihsan to your mother and your father. So in this ayat, Allah Ta'ala, He has put together the worship of Allah along with being diligent in taking care of one's parents. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said that the father or the mother, the wali, they are from the awsaf of abwabul jannah. They are from the best door of the doors of al-jannah. To get to jannah is through the parents. And he said it in another authentic hadith that the pleasure of Allah is in the pleasure of the parent. And the anger of Allah is in the anger of the parent. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in so many ayat of the Quran, in the way that He has legislated in this deen, He has caused the Muslims to look at the importance of the family in so many ayat. The way that Allah has legislated different aspects of the deen, He is telling the Muslims in these ayat to pay attention to the unification of the family. Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, and order your family to make the salah and to have the istibar and to have the sabr on it. So Allah ordered, tell your family, order them to have the salat, to make the salat, and also to have the sabr on the salat, the istibar on the salat. In another ayat, Allah Ta'ala said, oh, you believe, save yourself and save your family from the hellfire whose fuel is men and stone. The Shaykh, he went on to say, there is a benefit, a linguistic benefit that I want to share with you right now as it relates to the richness of the Arabic language. And that is a principle. That is, every time in the Arabic language, the mabna of the kalima, the way the word is, every time there's an added character on the word, then there's an added meaning that comes as a result. So here in this ayat, when Allah ordered, order your family with a salat and have an istibar. An istibar is from sabr. But sabr is different from istibar. He said sabr by itself means to have a tahammul. When you have to deal with something, you have to carry it and deal with it. Some affair comes, you have to have sabr. You have to deal with it and handle it. That's the meaning of sabr. And it's on this level. But when he ordered to have istibar, it becomes more higher in a meaning. It means now to carry it and also to be established, to be sabit on that thing. So in this ayat, when Allah ordered us to order our things with the salah and to be patient on it, it is a higher level of a sabr. He said, in this, as it relates to the oneness of the family, it comes and it is established in two ways as a result of the legislation. The first way is that a person has al-birr and he knows about the huquq. You have to be a person who is willing and ready to give people their rights after knowing their rights and having al-birr, having this thing about taking care of people. That's the first one. And the second one is that the Muslim has to come to know about the way to have khilaf, al-ikhtilaf. When it happens, one of the ways we remain together, we remain united, is that when the natural khilaf takes place, you have to know about the way to solve the differences in order to keep the family together. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, and if you disagree in anything from amongst yourselves, then refer it back to Allah and His Messenger. The Shaykh, he went on to say, this is the responsibility. We find, unfortunately, sometimes when the misunderstandings take place and the khilaf, it happens between the husband and the wife. For an example, the wife, right away, she hurry up and she says, oh, I want to get a khula. She wants to get out of the relationship. She wants to initiate the divorce because she's upset. The Sheikh said, she seems like she doesn't know to get a khula for an unjustified reason. It's from the kaba'ir, from the major sins. As the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, any woman who seeks a divorce from her husband, a khula, for a reason that is not justified, she will not smell the fragrance of al-Jannah. The Shaykh said, this is from the al-Fadh, the way Rasulullah said this hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that proves the woman who seeks a khula for a reason that's not justified is from the kabair, the major sin. And it seeks and helps to break up the unity of the family. And this is an example. So, if we want to maintain the unification and the unity and the togetherness of the family, then it becomes an obligation upon us that we follow what the religion has legislated as it relates to whenever differences arise, al-khilaf.
وإذ قد وجدت هذه الأسرة المسلمة على هذه الأرض وفي هذه الديار فلا بد أن تحافظ على وجودها وقيامها من حيث الرزق والمال ونحو ذلك. أما الرزق فينبغي الحرص على الرزق الحلال، فقد أخبر النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أنه سيأتي زمان على أمتي لا يبالي الواحد منا يأخذ ماله من حلال أو من حرام. والله عز وجل يقول من يتق الله يجعل له مخرجا ويرزقه من حيث لا يحتسب. ويقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن روح القدس، يعني جبريل، إن روح القدس نفث في روعي أنه لن تموت نفس حتى تستكمل رزقها وأجلها، فاتقوا الله وأجملوا في الطلب. ويقول عليه الصلاة والسلام إن الرزق ليطلب العبد أكثر مما يطلبه أجله، إن الرزق ليطلب العبد أكثر مما يطلبه أجله. فلماذا يتساهل الناس في دينهم لدراهم معدودة وأموال محدودة؟ لماذا يتهاون الناس في أرزاقهم فيشتغلون في المحرمات ويمارسونها طمعا في دنيا زائلة؟ والعياذ بالله تبارك وتعالى. وأما الأمر الثاني فهو الترفع عن أموال غير المسلمين، فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول اليد العليا خير من اليد السفلى، فالمسلم ينبغي أن يكون الأعلى
والأغلى والأرفع والأولى،
ولا يكون العكس. والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول أيضا: إني نهيت أو أنهيت عن ذبد المشركين، أي عن عطائهم وعطاياهم وأموالهم. فهذا التوسع الذي نراه من بعض المسلمين في صغير الأمور وكبيرها، في حقيرها وجليلها، في أخذ أموال غير المسلمين، هذا شأن لا يجوز ولا ينبغي، بل الأصل الترفع عنه واجتنابه حتى يبقى الوجود الإسلامي هذا محافظا على أصالته وعلى نقائه وعلى صفائه ما استطعنا إلى ذلك سبيلا.
Now, Ikhwan, the Sheikh came to the third point, tremendously important point. He said, if this Muslim family, this ideal Muslim family, if it is found on the earth, it finds that it is present, then it has to take care as it relates to being established and being established in the proper way, having its presence, it has to take care to protect and to safeguard its provision, its rizq, also its money, the money of the Muslim family. It has to be protected and taken care of. As for the rizq, the provision, he said, we have to take care to ensure and to make sure that the money that comes to us, it is money that is halal, not money that is haram. Because the Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, there's going to come a time, ama ummah, where the people are not going to be concerned, not going to be an issue with them, where their money comes from. A man will not be concerned where he gets his money, whether he gets it from the halal sources or the haram sources. Allah told us in the Quran, and whoever fears Allah, Allah will make a way out for him, and he will provide for him from a place where he doesn't expect. And the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, verily the Holy Spirit, the Ruhul Qudus, Jibreel, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, he came to me and he put into me, he told me, he revealed to me, Jibreel said to me, verily no soul is going to die until that soul exhausts all of the money, all of the risk that has been written for it, all of the money that's been decreed for each soul, also the time span of that soul. No soul will die until he gets his time span and until he gets every piece of money that was destined to him. So therefore, people, fear Allah and go after obtaining your money in a way that is good. Also, Ikhwan, the Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, verily a person's sustenance, his risk, is going to go after him and seek after him the same way, just as the death is coming after him. So the risk is going to come and it's going to get everyone, what has been decreed for the Muslim family. So therefore, the question that presents itself is, why are there some people who are lackadaisical as it relates to their deen? In order to get a few dirhams here, a few dirhams there, they do it at the expense of their religion. What has been written for you as it relates to your money, your rizq, it is going to come to you in its totality. Why would a person allow himself to become preoccupied and to work in a job or a profession in which that job that he's doing is haram just because he's greedy and he's desiring the dunya? Everything that has been decreed for you is going to come to you. That's the first point as it relates to the risk. The second point, as it relates to your risk and your money, is another important issue, and that is the need that the Muslim family has to rise above what is lowly and what is below. As it relates to taking money and being supported by the non-Muslims, taking the finances from the non-Muslims. The Rasul said, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, the upper hand is better than the hand that is on the bottom. The hand that is giving is better than the hand that's on the bottom that's receiving the help. So therefore, ikhwan, the Muslim, he has to be a person who is above being satisfied with being supported by the non-Muslims with the non-Muslim money. This is not something that is acceptable. In addition to that, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, verily I prohibit you from taking the gifts of the mushrikeen. Another way of understanding the hadith is that he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, verily I have been prohibited from taking the gifts of the mushrikeen. And the zab here, the sheikh said, it means the money of the kuffar, the gifts of the kuffar, what they give. I've been prohibited. I'm prohibiting you from it, and I've been prohibited from taking it. So the sheikh said, now we see that there is some tawassul, that the people are going overboard, and that the people are taking from the kuffar a lot, a little, and they're not paying attention. It's just something that they're taking. They take the money of the non-Muslim, and in the way that it's being done, this is la yajuz wa ma yanbaghi. It's not permissible, and it's not acceptable. It shouldn't be. So the origin of this thing about taking the money and being supported by their welfare, the asl of this, the origin of it is to leave it alone. Why? So that the Muslim family can remain and it can stand with honor, so that the Muslim family, it can be present and it is pure. It is not polluted. It is not contaminated as a result of what will come naturally from taking from them.
ورابع تلكم المقومات التي ينجلي بكمالها وتمامها وجود الأسرة المسلمة بصورتها النموذجية وبخاصة في بلاد الغرب التميز أن تكون هذه الأسرة متميزة وتميزها فيه المحافظة على هويتها بحيث لا تذوب ويكون لها حضورها وقدوتها وتأثيرها. وهنالك أمور عدة من عوامل التميز هذه، أذكر أربعة منها. أما أولها فاللغة العربية والتعلم لها ومعرفتها، فإني أعلم أن كثيرين من المهتدين ممن كانوا غير مسلمين إنما اهتدوا لما قرأوا معاني القرآن وشيئا من تفسيره، فكيف بالله لو عرفوا حلاوة القرآن بلغة العرب؟ والله عز وجل يقول إنا أنزلناه قرآنا عربيا غير ذي عوج، ويقول عز وجل إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم. مهما عرفت من معاني القرآن ومن دقائق تفسيره لن تكون هذه المعرفة تامة إلا بقدر ما تفقه من لغة العرب لتفهم أوامر الله كما يريد الله. فاللغة العربية لغة القرآن ولغة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فأولى وأولى بنا نحن المسلمين أن نحرص عليها وأن نرغب بها وأن نتعلمها وأن ندرك معانيها، حتى يكون التذوق الحق لحلاوة القرآن بكلماته وسياقاته وألفاظه وحروفه. بعض الآيات تغير فيها حرف، لماذا؟ حتى إذا فتحت أبوابها، وفتحت أبوابها، هنالك آية فيها الواو وآية بدون الواو، هذا له سبب وهذا له سبب. هذا لا يدركه من لا يعرف لغة العرب. فمن أسباب التميز الأسري والإسلامي بصورة عامة إدراك اللغة العربية. الأمر الثاني الأسماء، أن نحرص على أسمائنا الإسلامية. النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام كان يغير الأسماء القبيحة التي تدل على معان غير حسنة، فكيف إذا كانت أسماء غير إسلامية؟ فكيف إذا عرفنا أن بعض المسلمين وللأسف الشديد يستحيي من اسمه الإسلامي، يكون اسمه محمدا فيقول أنا مايك ليس محمد، نعوذ بالله. هذا ذوبان وانهدام. وهكذا اللباس، ذكرت أمس أن كثيرا من المسلمين بل غير المسلمين يحافظون على ملابسهم وأزيائهم القومية، فمن باب أولى أن نحافظ نحن المسلمين على لباسنا الإسلامي. وهنا فائدة فقهية، وهي أن اللباس الإسلامي ليس له صورة محددة، وإنما له وصف محدد. ليس له صورة محددة وإنما له صفات محددة. ألا يكون فيه إسبال، ألا يكون فيه تشبه بلباس الكفار، ألا يكون فيه ما يصف العورة أو يشف عنها، وهكذا. فهذه صفات للباس وليست صورة نمطية معينة للباس، فالمسلم يحرص على ذلك. والأمر الأخير عدم تقليد الكفار. وأنا ضحكت ويعني بيني وبين نفسي في السنة الماضية، وقد يكون هذا من قلة علمي وإدراكي للأمور، لكني أذكر ما وقع في نفسي، أنه للمرة الأولى يتم الإعلان عن عيد الأب. دائما نحن نعلم عيد الأم، أما عيد الأب هذا أنا لم أسمع به إلا في السنة الماضية. فهل هو كان موجودا من قديم لكن لم يفعل إعلاميا إلا في السنة الماضية؟ الله أعلم. المهم أن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال: لتتبعن سنن من كان قبلكم شبرا بشبر وذراعا بذراع حتى لو دخلوا جحر ضب لتبعتموه. قالوا: يا رسول الله، هل يهود والنصارى؟ قال: فمن، أي فمن غيرهم ومن سواهم. فالمسلم يجب أن يكون متميزا ليكون قدوة وأسوة، ليكون متبوعا لا تابعا، ليكون رأسا لا ذنبا. وهذا لا يكون له إلا بتحصيل هذا التميز المبني على كتاب الله وسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، دون اللحوق بأسوأ ما عند غير المسلمين الكفار أعني أيضا. فكثير من الناس لا يأخذون أجود ما عند الكفار غير المسلمين، وإنما يأخذون منهم أسوأ ما عندهم من صفات وعلاقات وسلوكيات، بحيث لا يكون لإسلامهم ذاك التميز المرجو والمطلوب. أسأل الله تبارك وتعالى لي ولكم التوفيق والسداد والهدى والرشاد، إنه سبحانه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
إخوان العرب، اصبروا على إخوانكم الأعاجم ولا تشوشوا عليهم بانصرافكم. The Sheikh said point number four and the last point in which he closed up his talk from the issues that we need to take care of as it relates to the ideal Islamic family and creating it and finding it, especially here in the West, is that the Islamic family, it has to have its tamayyuz. It has to be distinct. It has to be distinct, well recognized. We have to do our best to diligently try to maintain and preserve and nurture our own unique Islamic identity as it relates to the family, so that this Muslim family does not disappear, it does not melt inside of all of what's going on when it's in a place like this. No, the Muslim family, it has to have a ta'thir, it has to have an effect and an impact on its environment. And the way that that is done is by having a distinct personality that is recognized. The Sheikh said, this can be an issue that we can mention many points concerning. How do we develop the Islamic identity? There are many things, but in this short sitting, we're only going to deal with four issues. Remind you of four issues. Number one, that the Islamic family, in establishing its unique identity, it needs to pay attention to the Arabic language, learning it, coming to know about it, spending time educating one's family and oneself as it relates to the language of the Arab. The Sheikh, he said, we know that there are many, many people from our brothers and our sisters here who were originally from here. They were guided to the religion of Al-Islam. They were not Muslims at one time, but they received the Hidayah of Al-Islam as a result of reading some of the meaning of the Quran in their language that has been translated from Arabic to their language. They read about the explanation of the Quran and the tafsir of the Quran in their language. Now, how would it be if they actually knew Arabic language from the beginning? They would know and recognize and come to appreciate the sweetness of the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, verily we have revealed the Quran in Arabic, the clear Arabic where there is no crookedness in it. And Allah Ta'ala, He also said in the Quran, verily this Quran guides to what is aqwam, to what is best, what is most straight, what is most upright. So we have to come to know and to learn about this language. Ikhwani, no matter how much you come to know about the ma'ani or the meanings of the Quran and the detailed, minute sciences and treasures of the Quran, no matter how much you come to know about that, you will never have a complete understanding or appreciation of the Quran except when you develop an understanding of the Arabic language. Your understanding of the Arabic language will enable you to get a better understanding of the fiqh of the Quran itself, its language. You will come to understand the awamir of Allah Azza wa Jal, what Allah has ordered, the injunctions of the Quran. The Quran, ikhwan, and the Arabic language itself is the lugha. It is the language of the Quran, and it is the language of our Nabi salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. So therefore, I advise you to have the hirs and to hold on to the Arabic language so that you can make the idraq and you could come to know the true meaning of the Quran, so that you can have the tadawwuq, so that you can truly taste the reality of what this book is saying and come to know the truth about this book. It's alfaz, it's kalimat, because ikhwan, from the Quran is what we mentioned already. Every time an ayah is increased by one harf, one letter, one character, whenever the Quran, an ayah is increased by one letter, one harf, the meaning, it changes. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, for an example, hatta idha
zumar idha ja'uha wa futihat
hatta idha ja', the sheikh was saying, hatta idha ja'uha futihat abwabuha, when the qiyamah comes, when the paradise comes, it said, and the doors are open. It says, and the doors are open. That's one ayah. And then another ayah, the wow is added. وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا. This wow that was not in the first ayah, it comes in the second ayah. Basically, the same thing is being said, but there is a wow that is added. The Sheikh said, when this happens in the ayat of the Quran, that means there's an additional meaning. Something as small as that. So the point is, come and make yourself knowledgeable about learning the Arabic language. Sheikh said, point number two, the Islamic identity for the home, the unique identity. How do you take care of it? Number two, the name that we name ourselves. We have to hold on to, we have to preserve, we have to take care of naming ourselves by good Islamic name. Rasulullah salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, he used to change the names of his companions. Whenever one of them had a name that was qabiha, if they had bad names with bad meanings, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam changed that individual's name. What do you think would be the case for the name that is not a name of the Muslims? This a name of the non-believers, obviously it should be changed. So we should take care of our naming system and naming ourselves by Muslim names. Unfortunately, ikhwan, there are some Muslims who have haya. They are shy of their Islamic names. He has haya. He's shy and embarrassed about his Islamic name. A person's name is Muhammad, and then he says that his name is Mike, and the people laugh, but it's not fun. It's sad. It's reality. The Sheikh said we should be proud to take our name. Number three, the Islamic identity. How the usra is mutamayyiz, how it is distinct, is that we take care of holding on to our Islamic dress, the clothing, and what Muslims wear is what the Islamic family should preoccupy itself with. And there is a benefit in the fiqh of al-Islam. This is a fiqhi benefit, a fa'ida fiqhiya. The Sheikh said that the Islamic dress, it does not have a distinct way or picture that is muhaddida, is something, this is the Islamic dress, just like that. One particular peculiar dress is like that. Sheikh said, this is not the case, but the Islamic dress is defined by its characteristic. There are a number of characteristics that have to be present in order for a dress to be described as being Islamic dress. For an example, it cannot be al-isbal as it relates to the man. His clothing can't exceed his ankle bones. For an example, the dress cannot be the dress which resembles the kuffar and the way that they dress. Also, it cannot show his awrah, can't be exposed, or it defines the contours of his awrah. So the Islamic dress is not a specific way of dressing, no. But there are specific characteristics that have to be present. Number four, the way we hold on to this identity and establish this Islamic identity for the Islamic family, the ideal Islamic family, is that we do not do blind following. We do not follow the kuffar. Make taqleed of the kuffar. The Sheikh said that he laughed to himself. Last year when they came, he laughed to himself. And maybe the reason why he laughed came as a result of his lack of understanding, his lack of knowledge in this particular issue, but he'll share it with you. He said, last year was the first time that he ever heard of a celebration that is known as Father's Day. Father's Day. He said prior to that, last year, he heard of Mother's Day. Maybe the Islam. Maybe the media in the past, they didn't take care of making this a big issue, Father's Day. He doesn't know. But last year, he came to know about Father's Day. So when he heard about Father's Day, he thought that was funny. He thought that was a joke. So he laughed to himself. He said the reason why he is mentioning this is because we blindly follow these people in issues like this. And Allah's Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, told us, verily, you people, my ummah, you people, are going to follow the people. You are going to follow them a handspan by a handspan, an arm span by an arm span, to the point that if they enter into the lizard's hole, you will follow them into that hole. The companions say, Ya Rasulullah, are you talking about us following the Yahud and the Nasara? Rasulullah, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who other than that? Who else are the people going to follow the Yahud and the Nasara? So the Sheikh said, this is a sad thing. Whereas the Muslim family that is mutamayyiz, it has this unique identity. It is a qudwa. It's an example. It is an uswa. It is something to be followed. He said that the Muslim family, and you Muslim, you have to be a head, not a tail. You have to be the leader, not the follower. And the only way that you can be that way is by coming to know the kitab, coming to know and to embrace the authentic sunnah, and following the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and not following the kuffar in the evil things that they are doing. He said, unfortunately, there are many people from us, many people from amongst the Muslims. They don't take the good from the kuffar. They don't choose to take what the kuffar have, which is good and beneficial. But instead we find them always preoccupying themselves with being sure to take from the worst of what the kuffar have to offer. So with that, he brought his talk to a close and he made a number of dua for everyone.
Jazakumullahu khairan wa barakallahu.